a day, and welcome to Man, Land, and Sea. This show is designed to bring you news of Guam and her island environment. And now, the administrator of the Guam Coastal Management Program and your host, Michael Hamm.
Half a day. Welcome to another episode of Man, Land, and Sea. In way of introduction to this show, I'd like to read a brief paragraph. On July 22nd, during the Battle of Fonte Plateau, a black Doberman named Kurt was scouting at the front line when he discovered the Japanese defense line outpost. The battle that ensued was one of battalion strength involving approximately 800 Marines and countless hundreds of Japanese soldiers. Had Kurt not alerted the Marines to the Japanese presence, it is estimated that over 250 American Marines would have perished. Kurt was hit by mortar fire that opened a gaping wound in his neck, exposing his spinal cord. He was rushed to the War Dog Hospital, where Dr. Putney operated on him in an all-out effort to patch up an extensive wound. That night in his foxhole, Putney held the mortally wounded Kurt in his arms, cushioning him from the jumping earth as machine gun fire and rifle fire erupted around them. Kurt's wounds were too severe, and at 3 a.m. on July 23, 1944, as machine gun fire cracked overhead, Kurt stopped breathing. By this time, Dr. Putney was totally exhausted and emotionally drained from watching his patient slowly die. He rested his head on Kurt's chest and fell asleep. Kurt thus became the first war dog casualty on Guam territory. The Marine Provost Marshal, Major Tonus, awakened Dr. Putney in the morning, expressing his sympathies to the young veterinarian and attempting to console him over the loss of Kurt. The grieving veterinarian asked the Major what he should do with the body. His reply was, "Kurt died like a Marine, and he deserves to be buried as a Marine." That is how Kurt, the first war dog casualty on Guam soil, and the other 23 dogs came to be buried in the Marine cemetery that has been established in a rice paddy just inland from the invasion beach at Assen. We'll be back in just a moment to talk about the war dogs of Guam.
Half a day. I'm Gilbert Acosta with the Department of Agricultural Wildlife Section. This month we feature the brown tree snake. Guam has a reputation for being infested with the brown tree snake, known in Chamorro as the culebra. They prefer to travel and feed at night. While most frequently seen in rural areas, they are often found in urban areas, sometimes hanging from power lines. These snakes eat lizards, rats, mice. They do reduce our population of vermin, but they don't stop there. The brown tree snake is aggressive in its pursuit of birds, eggs, and small animals. This broad range of food preferences and the rapid expansion of the snake population are major factors in the loss of our bird populations. They take their prey through a combination of poisoning, constricting, and crushing. Yes, the brown tree snake is mildly venomous, but delivers its poison through the back of its teeth, which require a long chewing bite. The culebra starts life as a leathery egg, tucked away in a hollow tree or other place. On hatching, the snake is typically 15 inches long, and in 1 year is about 3 feet long, and fully mature snake can grow to 10 feet. These snakes occur naturally in Papua New Guinea, the Solomon Islands, and Northern Australia, and may have gotten here by hiding in ship's cargo. In order to prevent further spread to other places and reduce its population here on Guam, significant federal and local efforts are underway to prevent snakes from being carried out of Guam and conduct information gathering that may result in effective control methods. Snake trapping and specially trained snake hunting dogs are some of the tools used by snake hunters. The brown tree snake story illustrates the dangers of introducing non-native species. The cost to Guam has been very high, no matter how it is measured. What can you do to help? First, kill or capture the snakes. Then, support the scientific efforts underway to find an effective way to eliminate this pest. For Man, Land, and Sea, I'm Gilbert Acosta.
Welcome back. We are going to be talking today about the history of the war dogs on Guam and, in fact, about the dogs that we have here today. And the paragraph that I read at the opening of the show was written by my guest, Captain Joseph P. Comet from the U.S. Navy. Welcome to Man, Land, and Sea, and thank you for that beautiful introduction that I was able to read.
Thank you, Mike. It's a pleasure for me to be here, and I want to thank Channel 12 Public Television for the opportunity to tell Guam a story which not too many of you know about, a story of the heroism of these dogs of World War II, the role that they played in helping to liberate the island from Japanese occupation. I also want to acquaint you with the unique War Dog Cemetery, which has had several locations over the past 53 years, but which is now down at the Naval Station on our historical trail. We'll be visiting that later in the segment. But to tell this story properly, I need to go back about 53 years to the early battles of World War II, when the Americans realized that the battles with the Japanese in these South Pacific islands were going to be unique types of warfare. Unlike the standard warfare of European theater, this was going to be battles in jungles, where there would be hideouts, there would be ambushes, there would be caves, there'd be rough terrain. This was going to be a very difficult type of battle for the Marines, and they soon realized this in the Battle of Guadalcanal in 1942. Following huge losses of American Marines in Guadalcanal, they decided that they would be able to use the unique talents and innate abilities of dogs to augment the Marines and to warn them for encroaching ambushes and attacks by the Japanese in these caves and in these island settings. So they established a war dog boot camp at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina in early 1943. This boot camp accepted, well, I believe there were about 1,430 dogs of various descriptions, mostly Doberman Pinschers, German Shepherds, a few Heinz 52 variety mutts, a collie or two, and a black Labrador. These dogs were donated by their families to the war effort. They were donated and they were inducted into the Marine Corps, given honorary titles of private, lance corporal. And there was an agreement with these families that should the dogs survive combat, they would be returned. And many indeed did return to their families at the end of the war. But the heroism of these dogs are stories that are tearjerkers, stories that will really be of great interest to you as we develop them. And I'm so glad I'm able to talk to you about it. But anyway, the boot camp in 1943 at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, trained these dogs as you would train a human recruit. They went into recruit training and, of course, got their physical examinations and were evaluated for their ability to, their intelligence, their ability to obey commands, their ability to adapt to wartime training. Many people that donated their dogs felt that the vicious dog, the one that was uncontrollable, would be a great fighter in the jungles, but that was untrue. What we needed in the war effort were Dobermans and German Shepherds, other types of dogs that were intelligent, that were controllable, that were smart. And so they went through a screening process when they went into boot camp, and those that survived then started a 12-week training course at Camp Lejeune. I believe there were over 250 that flunked out of the boot camp in the first few days of training. But they first went through 6 weeks of basic training where they learned silent commands, because in a jungle battlefield, you certainly can't be barking out orders to your dogs. So they went through silent command basic training. And then if they survived that first 6 weeks, they were beginning to be exposed to actual combat situations where they had exploding ammunition going on around them and fires and smoke and what have you. Following 12 weeks at Camp Pendleton, at Camp Lejeune, they were then shipped across country for advanced field training at Camp Pendleton, California, where they were married up with actual human Marine battalions that began to train for the war in the Pacific. So this was quite an investment in time and energy to get these dogs ready for battle. They had their first successful campaign in Bougainville in New Guinea in 1943. And because of the great success there and the numbers of casualties that they were able to prevent, they went on and fought very successfully here in Guam, in Saipan during mop-up operations for the Saipan evolution. They then went to Peleliu for the battle there, and they served in Iwo Jima and finally in Okinawa. So they have a wonderful history of service to the Marine Corps. While on Guam, they led over 550 patrols through the jungles and are responsible for saving thousands and thousands of American Marines' lives. Now I need to start telling you the story of their young veterinarian by the name of Lieutenant William Putney, who was right out of his veterinary training school at Auburn University and was assigned to the war dog boot camp at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. Dr. Putney began training these war dogs for service in the South Pacific and was eventually assigned as the commanding officer of the 3rd War Dog Platoon. He took his dogs and his handlers and went on to Bougainville, where he joined the great flotilla headed by Fleet Admiral Chester Nimitz. And this flotilla of nearly 1,000 ships and the Marines and, of course, our war dogs headed into the waters of Saipan and Guam and fought in the Marianas Turkey Shoot and then with the Battle of Saipan and the Battle of Guam. On the 21st of July, 1944, with the first wave of Marines that came ashore at the landing beach in Assen, Dr. Putney and his fellow commanding officer, Lieutenant Taylor of the 2nd War Dog Platoon, landed on the beaches of Assen and began scouting for the Marines up the hills of towards Fonte Plateau, through the Assen battlefield to Fonte Plateau. In the course of the battle to liberate Guam, 24 war dogs and 3 war dog handlers were killed. And you open this segment with the story of the first war dog that was killed, the war dog Kurt. We have photographs of Kurt that I'm sure you're going to be showing our audience. Kurt was the first to die. And you also told the story of how the war dogs cemetery came into existence. The Marines were so delighted with these dogs and their performance that they considered them fellow Marines, and they did bury them with the Marines on the banks of the Assen River in a rice paddy. In 1946, after the war was over, the American human Marines that died were returned to their families in the United States. However, the war dogs remained behind on the battlefield in their cemetery. This cemetery survived all the way through till 1963 when Typhoon Karen hit Guam, and we all know what Typhoon Karen's strength was, but it destroyed the War Dog Cemetery. Gov Guam then moved the tombstones from this cemetery to the jungles of Dedado. As you remember, a few years ago you might have seen a sign off of Route 8 pointing to the War Dog Cemetery in Dedado. Unfortunately, over the years, vandalism affected this cemetery, and when Dr. Putney returned in 1983, he found the War Dog Cemetery fully overgrown with jungle. The tombstones had been tipped over, and the cemetery itself had been desecrated. He was so devastated because of his love for his animals that he determined at that time he was going to do something special to honor them for the 50th anniversary of the liberation. He went back to the United States and he contacted the United Doberman Club of the United States and got them to fund the construction of a $40,000 bronze statue of Kurt, the first dog to die. And this statue was done by Susan Bahai Wilner, and you will see this statue when we visit the cemetery shortly after this. The statue was Another thing that Dr. Putney wanted to do was to relocate the War Dog Cemetery to its original position on the banks of the Acid River. His attempts were unsuccessful because in the interim years the property had been sold and was privately owned. And so that was not possible. Having a wonderful dog statue and no place to relocate the cemetery, he contacted myself, and I in turn got with Government of Guam, National Park Service, and the Veterans Affairs Office of the island, and we found a location on the naval station on our historical trail to permanently, to act as a permanent spot for the War Dog Cemetery. The Seabees cleared jungle overgrowth and actually remounted the monument and the tombstones, and we now have a beautiful lasting memorial to these war dogs and to their story that you'll be visiting shortly. Dr. Putney has been forever grateful to Guam and for honoring his war dogs that he tried so hard to preserve their stories with. And we will be visiting that cemetery very shortly.
Yeah, actually, we will be going out to see the statue of Kurt and some of the dogs that will be honoring Kurt in actually towards the end of this program, very briefly. In the meantime, before we get into that, let's take a break for another segment, and we'll come back and we'll finish up this story, meet one of today's dogs,
right,
and then visit the War Dog Cemetery on Naval, it's Naval Facilities?
It's presently Naval Facilities. It'll be renamed shortly to Comnat Base Guam.
Okay. We will be right back then to meet more with the dogs and hear more of their story. We'll be right back.
Half a day and welcome to Dave's Tip. I'm Dave Duenas with the Guam Coastal Management Program, and this month we'll be providing tips to you on how to avoid food poisoning. Be sure to keep foods covered at all times. Place meat and prepared food in the refrigerator if not eaten immediately. Store all potentially hazardous foods in the refrigerator, such as chicken, dairy products, and seafood. Refrigerator temperature should be at or below 40 degrees. Wash hands after handling garbage, poisons, and before handling dishes or food. Be sure that the food preparation area is thoroughly clean. For Dave's Tip, I'm Dave Duenas, and I'll see you next month.
Welcome back. Joining myself and Captain Comet on the set is Petty Officer John O'Brien, who is with the Canine Division of Naval Activities Security Department, and John's partner, Dino. Welcome. John, would you tell us a little bit about how Dino is trained and what his function is here on Guam today?
With the Military Working Dog Program, it starts in Department of Defense, like an Air Force base, is where the school is for the entire Military Working Dog Program. They start there. The training will vary. Patrol will start first, then the narcotics and explosives. Each dog is trained initially in both fields to find out what they specifically best in. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately for dogs like Dino, aggressiveness also takes a big part in their training. If they're over-aggressive, the chances of being narcotics certified or explosive certified is minimal because of the standards they got to meet for that criteria. Him specifically, he is just a patrol dog, which I utilize on the field every day on patrol with traffic stops. We do building searches if there's an open door, if something was to happen with the anybody lost in the woods or children lost in the woods, or if we're looking for somebody who ran into the woods, say, or a building, he's also capable of sniffing them out via the scent, also as well as hearing and seeing any perpetrator or a suspect in a building or in the woods.
But how does the relationship work? That you are partners.
Yes.
On a 24-hour basis, how does the relationship work? Do you only see him at work, or?
We spend about 5 hours each day together, mm-hmm. every day, Monday through Friday, doing training primarily. Our mission here, it varies. Again, excluding him, because he's just a straight patrol dog, he doesn't get to see none of the searches that the narcotics dogs see, as well as the bomb detecting dogs see. Him and I just spend most of our time on the road doing traffic stops and just regular security operations on a day-to-day function. Once we're completed with our shift, we'll go back to our kennel area and do controlled aggression, which he specializes in, and also scouts. We'll just pick an open field someplace. Again, working with the dog handlers, we wear body suits, we have wraps we also use to put on their arms for bites and purposes like that, and we'll send somebody into the woods, say, and we'll go in after him, mm-hmm. searching for him. His ability right now is, he's the best dog we have of the six dogs we own right now in the Naval Activity Security Department for scouting. But again, his purposes are limited to just strictly patrol field.
Is he going to be staying here on Guam? The people rotate out. Will Dino stay here now for the next handler to come along, next partner?
Yes, he will. He'll stay as long as he stays healthy. Once he gets certified on the island with the base CO, he'll maintain that certification until a new handler comes in, at which time he has to maintain a new certification with them, and it'll just keep rotating. We stay here about 24 months.
So Dino is a resident of Guam now.
Yes, he is.
Welcome to Guam, fella. Yeah. What we're going to do now is very special. We're going to take a break and go down to the War Dog Cemetery itself and learn a little bit about the stories of some of the dogs that died, and to memorialize Kurt and some of the original dogs that did die here. Just a note before we go down there, the repeat of this show that you're seeing now, the Monday repeat, is on July 21st, which is the anniversary of the invasion. But for the purposes of this show, it is 2 days before the anniversary of Kurt's death, the first war dog to die on Guam. So 2 days from now, on Wednesday the 23rd, take a minute out and remember Kurt and the other dogs who did a lot to save human lives on this island. We will be back after the ceremony and the portion of the show down at the War Dog Cemetery.
Cappy was a black and tan Doberman Pinscher who was killed on Cabras Island in August 1944 after the battle to liberate Guam was officially over. Six Japanese soldiers who had not surrendered were seen heading across the causeway from what is now Marine Drive onto Cabras Island. A Marine sentry spotted them and contacted Lieutenant Putney, the commanding officer of the 3rd War Dog Platoon, for assistance in apprehending these holdouts. Dr. Putney responded with 4 war dogs, Butch, Coco, Rusty, and Cappy, and their 4 dog handlers. Cappy led the team down the length of Cabras Island and froze when he came to a large pile of rocks being used to construct the breakwater. As he alerted Dr. Putney and the dog handlers to the Japanese soldiers waiting in ambush, he was shot in the chest and killed instantly. At the risk of his own life, Cappy's dog handler, Private Terrell, leapt forward and grabbed Cappy in his arms and raced back behind a large boulder for cover. Dr. Putney described the scene where Private Terrell was cradling the body of his dead dog in his arms, covered in the dog's blood and crying uncontrollably. A dog and his handler were bonded as a pair at the Devil Dog Boot Camp and lived and worked together exclusively for the duration of the war or until one was killed. When the dog handler lost his animal, it was like the death of a family member. Dr. Putney credits Cappy with taking the bullet meant for him and thereby saving his life. If Cappy had not alerted the men of a pending ambush, they all would have been killed. Private Terrell continued to serve in the War Dog Platoon after Cappy's death, but was later killed on Iwo Jima.
I want to thank my very special guest today, Captain Joseph Komet, Petty Officer John O'Brien, and Dino for joining me. We'll be back next month. Thank you.
This program is funded in part through a grant for the Guam Coastal Benjamin Program, Bureau of Planning, Governor of Guam, provided by